Well, it's good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. If you're able to, let's stand together and let's sing a couple choruses to start off with. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart, and I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice, for he hath made me glad. He hath made me glad. He hath made me glad. I will rejoice, for he hath made me glad. He hath made me glad. He hath made me glad. I will rejoice, for he hath made me glad. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing. I will sing. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness, thy faithfulness. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. For those who like to use the hymn book, page 405, My Faith Has Found a Resting Place. My faith has found a resting place, not in device nor greed. I trust the ever-living One, His wounds for me shall plead. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. Enough for me that Jesus saves, this sins my fear and doubt. A sinful soul, I come to him, he'll never cast me out. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. My heart is leaning on the word, the written word of God. Salvation by my Savior's name, salvation through his blood. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. My great physician heals the sick, the lost he came to save. For me his precious blood he shed, for me his life he gave. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, amen, died for me. It is enough. Let's turn to page 172. Tell me the story of Jesus. I'm sorry, page 358. 358, I am thine, O Lord. If I just looked to the back, I'd know. 358, I am thine, O Lord.
I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer. Blessed Lord, to the cross where
Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Oh, the purity light of a single hour that before thy throne I stand. When I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, we commune as friend with thee. Amen. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea, that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side.
And page 172, tell me the story of Jesus.
Tell me the story of Jesus, right on my heart.
prayer. You may be seated. It's a blessing to be in the house of God tonight. Blessing to be gathered with each one of you. We got quite a few visitors here tonight. We just want to thank y'all for your visit. If this is your first time, there should be a visitor's card in front of you. If you desire to, we'd love to have a record of your visit. Just fill it out and just hand it to one of us men on the way out, and we'd love to be able to reach out to you and let you know how thankful we were that you came and joined us for these services. As you probably know, most of you, Brother Wesley, Miss Lori, and the boys are out of town, and they're in South Padre Island. They left on Monday. They'll be back on Friday, so they got away for a few days. We're excited for them, and we're excited that we have Brother Kevin, who's going to be preaching for us tonight. So let's keep them all in prayer, and especially Brother Kevin, as he prepares to come and preach for us tonight. Amen. The shower for baby Ezra, I believe the box has been removed. So if you didn't get something to them and you desired to do so, or maybe you've already bought it, you just forgot to bring it, when you see them on Sunday, you can give it to them then. Amen. So Brother Timo or Miss Emily, the meals for the bells that we're doing, Miss Wanda, who's had these strokes, I'm not sure if there's any slots left. I believe a lot of the people in our church, a lot of the ladies have been taking these slots to provide meals for them. But if you're interested, who would they get with? Miss Monica? They can just use the barcode that's on the bulletins. We still have more bulletins out here on the back. If you go out these doors, right there to your right on that ledge there, there's more bulletins and there's a barcode there. We have the Irwin family. The children of Brother Dennis Irwin are going to be coming on the 30th of this month. They're going to be with us on our new stage, and the Lord's new stage. And they're going to be singing here at Parkwood Baptist Church, so that's exciting. It's always fun to have the young people come and to have these groups come too. And so y'all be in prayer for them. They're getting ready to start the meeting that goes on at Canton every year. I believe it starts Monday. Can anybody confirm that?
I believe you're right.
It starts on Monday. So they're going to have a lot of good groups singing up there and a lot of good preaching up there. It's always fun to be able to get away and go up there. And a lot of our people in our church have done that for many years. Brother Mark Thrift, who was pastor for here for over 30 years, he'll be preaching at least one of those services. There's a secret sister reveal that's going on August 5th. Now, if you don't have a secret sister or wasn't a part of it, you are still welcome to attend if you're a lady. And that's on August 5th at 10 a.m. right here at Parkwood Baptist Church. So we'd love to have you come. Even if you're a visiting lady and you're interested in maybe attending here, you're more than welcome to attend. It's a good way to get to know some of our ladies. Any other announcements that I've missed? Anyone else? Yes, Miss Cecilia.
Pray for Kenny. His surgery is this Friday.
That's right. Brother Kenny is having cancer removal surgery on Friday, and he's going to be out for at least a couple weeks. Hey, that would be wonderful. Well, let's keep Brother Kenny in our prayers as he goes through the surgery. All right. I believe that is it. So, Brother Kevin, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Well, good evening, church. Different view, but all for the glory of God. If you have your Bibles open, your Bibles with me at Ephesians chapter number 1. Last time I was privileged to preach here, I also preach on Ephesians 1. I took the first 15 verses, and I liked it so much, I said, let's do a continuation. So I want to preach for the next verses from verses 15 to 23. And just to give you kind of like the purpose of this book is that the unity that we have in Jesus Christ. And that's just a matter of introduction. The previous verses to this book, basically God made a predetermined choice before the foundation of the world that all of it will be gathered in Jesus Christ at the end of times. And he wanted to, and that decision affects today, and it'll affect tomorrow, and it'll affect eternity, and all because he will it through and by the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, that you will find that in verse 10. That's the purpose of the whole book. But let's read from verse 15 to verse 23. The Bible says, "Wherefore I also, after hearing your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know that what is the hope of his calling, and what are the riches of his glory, of the inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards that believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ, when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all." Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, I ask you tonight that you may use me as a vessel for your glory. Father, that the prayers tonight that are echoed throughout this world, O Lord, that may be bring glory and honor to you, O Lord, that you will work according to your will, what your perfect will has designed, O Lord, that we will be united in Christ. Father, we may come to know you, the only true God. We ask you tonight that you will bless the people here, bless the people who are not, that you will provide for them. And Father, I just ask you one more time, O Lord, to use me as a vessel for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. I want to talk to you about prayer for the saints tonight, or intercession for the saints, if you want to put it that way. Now, I don't want to put you in the spot here tonight, but again, I did some self-reflection based on this text. Normally when you pray, you normally pray for me, myself, and I. Correct? I mean, there's nothing wrong with it. We have problems, we have difficulties, right? We do commit sin, and therefore we pray mostly for ourselves. And then sometimes we say, oh yeah, then let's pray for such and such a person, and we make it maybe short and sweet, right? Maybe true, maybe that's me, I don't know. You know your heart, you know your prayer life. But here the Apostle Paul, he takes this verse right here, and I like what it says here in verse 15 and 16. It says, "Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints," Paul says this, "I cease not to give thanks to you for making mention to you in my prayers." Therefore, the Apostle Paul spends every single day to making prayer for the saints in Ephesus, the ones that are saved in the blood of Jesus Christ, who are called into the family of God. He says, "What I've heard of you makes me glad of the love that you show and the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I'm praying for you." Do you like when people pray for you? You know, I remember Ken Trivett, one day he was here at our missions conference, and he said he was a pastor and he had a big church for what he tells, and then God called him to the mission field. And he's right now serving at the Indians in North Dakota. I forgot the tribe name. And he said, he made a statement that always resounds to my mind. You know, we always say, you hear missionaries come and say, and even though your support is good, but it's your prayers that keep us in the mission field. And he said, I'm in that side of the spectrum. And he says, I agree. Support is good, but it's the prayers of our brothers and sisters that keep us in the mission field, because we're not depending on the support of men. We're depending on the support of God. And in this text that I want to bring you today, it's a prayer that I think you and I, as brothers and sisters in the church, to come to the unity of God and Jesus Christ, we ought to make the same prayer that the Apostle Paul mentions here about interceding for one another, but for one purpose, that we ought to know God. Let me ask you a question. Is it good to pray for people that are sick? We Brother Cecilia mentioned Brother Kenny. Should we pray for Brother Kenny? Obviously we should. We ought to do it. We pray for Miss Wanda and some other people. Maybe there's some other people in your circle that you may know. You pray for them to have an illness. But let me tell you something. Does that compare to knowing the person of God? What is higher than the person of God? That ought to be our desire. That ought to be our thrust. That ought to be the purpose of our local church, that we ought to know God. Again, and I believe this with all my heart, if you and I are drawn closer to the knowledge and relationship of God, I promise you the fights inside of the churches will disappear, the fellowship will grow even more, we will pray more fervently one for another, and we will be more united than ever because we're coming to the knowledge of God. Samuel says here, let me tell you something. 1 Samuel 12:23, when he's talking to Saul, he said, "Furthermore, as for me, far it be that I should sin against the Lord by ceasing to pray for you." Samuel said it's a sin to stop praying for one another. And again, in our prayers, like I said, I don't know if it's you, but sometimes we pray for me, myself, and I. Nothing wrong with that. But how much of your time and your prayer you dedicate for others? And yet more important, for them to know the Lord. A.W. Pink says this, "The measure of our love for others can largely be determined by the frequency and earnestness of our prayers for them." You know, we always like to say, "I love you, brother," right? But how often do we really demonstrate that love? And what A.W. Pink said here, we really show that when we pray for one another. So there's three things I want to talk to you tonight in this text that we ought to pray for one another. And I hope and I pray that we can leave tonight with something practical, something with truth, and at the same time, something that we can put in practice every day for that we can go closer to the unity towards God and Jesus Christ. The first thing I want you to know is in verse 17, that we may know in this prayer that we pray for one another, is that they may know the excellency of God. Verse 17 says, "That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him." Now, the excellency of God, I want you to see that God is incomparable. You cannot compare to Him. Verse 17 says it clearly right there, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory. And that word glory in the Greek language is the word doxa, where we get the word doxology. But it literally means the quality of splendid or remarkable in appearance. May I tell you tonight, when you and I really understand and may comprehend who God really is, and may I tell you tonight, let's say God today pulls the curtain of time and space and He reveals His full glory today, what would be our response? My greatest analogy or example I can give you to you, when Isaiah saw the Lord in Isaiah chapter number 6, he says this, "Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." One day you and I will see God. And my question is, how much of this God do we know? How incomparable He is? In the book of Psalms, there's a verse that says, "The nations have their idols, but the Lord made the heavens." With that saying that the Lord is incomparable, the nations created their own idols. But yet the Lord, He created everything else. How can we compare to the Lord? Well, we understand how much God has done and how incomparable it is. Just read the first 14 verses and put into the lens how powerful and how incomparable God is. Again, like I told you in my introduction, in those previous verses, He made a decision before even time ever began. And let me tell you, it's still affecting us today, and it will affect us for eternity, for His glory and for His honor. And He is incomparable. Look what the psalmist says in Psalms 89. From verses 5 to 8, it says, "And the heavens shall praise thy wonders, O Lord, thy faithfulness also in the congregation of the saints. For who in the heaven can be compared unto the Lord? Who among the sons of the mighty can be likened unto the Lord? God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints, and to be had in reverence of all of them that are about of him. O Lord, God of hosts, who is strong, Lord, like unto thee, or unto thy faithfulness round about thee." Look what God had to say about Himself in Isaiah 40, verses 25 and 26. It says, To whom would ye liken me? Or shall I be equal, saith the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high, and behold, who hath created these things that bring it out their hosts by number? He calleth them all by names, by the greatness of His might, for He is strong in power, not one faileth." Question, who can compare to God? That's why when the Apostle Paul is praying this prayer for the saints in Ephesus, he's saying, I want you to know the excellency of God, that He is incomparable. He's the Father of glory. No one can compare to Him. Nothing will be able to compare to Him. And even God Himself in the book of Isaiah, I just remembered this verse, He says, before me there was no God, and after me there will be none like other, like me. And that's the Apostle Paul is praying to this God, that He, that the people in Ephesus may know the excellency, that who He is, that He is incomparable. But at the same time as He is incomparable, He is unexhaustible. In other words, you can never run out of God. Amen? You can never run out of God. Have you ever sometimes been eating at a restaurant and the food is so good and you're so sad you took in the last bite because you know there's no more after this? Amen. Especially when you get a good piece of steak. But yet I tell you something, God is someone that you will never, ever run out to know about Him. Because verse 17, look what it says here, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him. The Apostle Paul is saying, brethren, I'm praying for you in this matter, that you may know how God is excellent, so that you may know that you will never run out of God. There's enough for everybody in this room. There's enough for you in this lifetime. And I promise you, there's enough time for God for all eternity, because He never runs out. And I want you to notice here the word knowledge here. So sometimes we read that word and we think like a knowledge of understanding. But what He's really saying here, the Greek word is epignosos. That means super knowledge. But it's a knowledge of relationship. Now, I can talk this about experience. I have a unique relationship with my spouse. And there's some looks. There's some way that she says some things that I know immediately what she's thinking or what she wants to do or what she's saying. Am I right, fellas? Yes, amen. And wife, I hope you also have that same relationship with your man, that you know when he's doing some things, you know exactly what he needs. Sometimes a big piece of steak. But okay. But the point is what Paul is saying here, that you may have the knowledge of God. You may know how excellent it is by spending time with God. Sometimes we're very good at evangelizing and saying, you need the Lord and be saved. Amen? And I believe that. But yet sometimes we forsake sometimes how you and I grow in our spiritual life is by spending time with the Lord. And how do we spend time with the Lord? How you spend time with your spouse. You spend time with them. You just make time and spend time with them. Verse 17 says that He may give unto you the spirit or the breath of wisdom and revelation. That word wisdom means that you have the capacity to understand, and the word revelation, that He makes Himself fully known. You know, as God is infinite in all that He is, and we're finite, but God is saying, I'm going to give you all of myself to you, and you will have the wisdom to understand, and you will have the revelation that I will pull back the curtain, that you can see me for who I am. Question, if you study all the religions of all the world, there's only one religion that makes the difference between all things, because all the gods of other religions always say, what can you do for me? But yet the God of the Bible says, this is what I've done for you. And I want to pull the curtain to reveal myself to you so that you may spend time to know me. I pray that someone will pray for me that prayer as well, saying, Father, may Kevin may know you more as he spent time with you. How precious that is. For me, it's a blessing. And the Apostle Paul is saying the most important thing that you and I should know is that we may know God and spend time with Him so He can give us the wisdom and full revelation of who He is. Proverbs chapter 2, verses 4 to 6 says this, if thou seekest her as silver and searchest her as for a hid treasure, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord giveth wisdom. Listen now, out of His mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. If you want to know God, simple. Spend time with God. Spend time with God. And I encourage you, pray for one another that they may also know God, so that when they spend time with God, God may be fully revealed Himself to them, and they may come to the knowledge of Him, and therefore we ought to be better Christians every day as we spend time with God. John Saltmarsh says this prayer is none other than the revelation of the will or mind of God. Do we pray for one another in this sense, that they may know the excellency of God? The second thing I want to give to you also, not only that we may pray that they may know the excellency of God, but that God may enlighten them. Verse 18 reveals to this. It says that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling and what is the riches of his glory, of the inheritance in the saints. The Apostle Paul is saying here that God, Father, open their eyes so they may see the full perception of who you are. It's like when the psalmist says in Psalms 119, verse 18, look what it says, open thou my eyes that I may behold wonderful things out of thy law. The psalmist is saying, Lord, when I spend time in your word, open your eyes that I may see a wonderful thing in your law. Lord, talk to me. Show me something that I need to see today, something that I can put in practice today, something that I may be able to know you and understand you. You know, I remember Adrian Rogers once says, he said, the only time I preach a message when I soak it in prayer in front of God. And trust me, out of experience, I've noticed sometimes the best prayer, the best message that sometimes I give is when I constantly spend time in prayer looking at the passage and I'm telling God, tell me what you're trying to say to me that I may tell to others. And sometimes I get a great blessing out of that. Even Charles Spurgeon says, I've found that the meaning of the text can be better learned by prayer than any other way. And that is true. At least by experience, I can tell you that is true. Prayer activates the word of God, the power of God, so that our eyes can open for the truth that God wants to tell us. And to be honest, who's better than God? I mean, sometimes we go like, sometimes I can go to commentaries and study this text, but sometimes I say, Lord, what is that you want to tell me? I don't want to hear X, Y, and Z person. I want to hear what you have to say in this text. Lord, help me. But also why we need to have our eyes enlightened, why we need to be enlightened by God. Well, very simple. The verse 18 continues that you may what? Know. To have the understanding, again, to have to possess all the information. What does God want us to know? It says it in the text. What is the hope of his calling and what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance? Well, let's go with the first one. What is hope? Hope is an assurance of things that will come. Who is our blessed hope? The Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He is the hope of glory, the Bible calls him. He is the one that said that he will come again. Wesley preached very good on John 14 last Sunday, where he says, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. And I go and prepare a place unto you so that where I am, you may be also. And I will come again, he says, and take you unto my own. Amen. That is a blessing. That is our blessed hope. And may I tell you tonight, so that we may know our hope, so therefore we can grow closer to the knowledge of God through the relationship that we have in Jesus Christ, that we all can become one and that we know without a shadow of a doubt what is the hope that we have in him. Amen. You know, I heard a sermon that says, you know, it's good to be saved. Amen. Amen. You know what's even better than that, he said? I was thinking, what can be better than being saved? He said, to know that you're saved. I said, amen to that. I agree. It's good to know that you're saved, amen? And he said, there's something even better than that. I said, ooh, Lord, what else? And he says, to know that your salvation cannot be lost because it's secure in Jesus Christ. And I said, ooh, amen to that. Because verse 17, or 18, excuse me, it says there, what is the hope of his calling? And what is his calling? If you have time, read verse number 5, that we've been called to be adopted into the children according to the redeeming blood of Jesus Christ, because he predestined it to be so. Amen. So when God called me, he says, I give you a hope that is guaranteed and that you may fully know what is that hope. Amen. Amen. And then verse 18, it says, and what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? Question, how rich is God? Yet he made the heavens and the earth. Is there something that does not belong to him? Yet all things belong to him, and therefore he's rich. But I'll tell you how rich he is. If you go back to verse 6, just go back with me to the previous verse. 6, 7, and 8. Look what it says here. To the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he's made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, wherein he has abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. In other words, God has done all this according to the riches of his grace. And verse number 8 said he gave us all his grace. And therefore, when God is rich, he says, I'm going to give you all of it, that what I have of my inheritance. And again, what is his inheritance? It says it right there. And what is the glory of his inheritance in the saints? That, well, you know what's the inheritance of God? Himself. Amen? Himself. I can leave an inheritance to my son today, but yet when he dies, that's it, it's gone. But yet what I want to give to my son or what I want to give to people is that what they can get in God, it will never, ever disappear because it's based on the riches of the glory of God. In the Old Testament, if you study the book of Joshua, when you know it's an inheritance, he tells the Levites, you're not going to have a land for an inheritance, but your inheritance will be me. You will serve me. You will prepare everything on the temple for me. Your duties will be to me. I will be your inheritance. And the New Testament, guess what is our inheritance? Himself. Again, it's himself. I don't know if that excites you, but it excites me. Because this world will go. Jesus said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word abideth forever. And he that remaineth unto the Son liveth forever, has everlasting life. I want that more than anything else. And that is a prayer that I wish that someone would pray for me that says, Kevin, I'm praying for you that your eyes may be enlightened, that you may come to understand, to know what is the hope and the riches of them. May I know it all today. Again, God is infinite. I may not know everything today, but as more as I walk with the Lord, the more I spend time with him, the more I come to understand who he is, and the more he reveals himself to me, the better it will be for me to know the enlightenment that he can give to me. And the third thing I want to give you, and I'll finish with this, is in verse 19. It says, I put it plain and simple, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe according to the working of his mighty power? Basically, the third point here is that also that you may know what is the exceeding greatness of his power. The word exceeding means there is not comparison, and the word greatness, again, is beyond imagination. That's what it's saying, that God has a power that you and I may never to be able to comprehend. Again, if you read Genesis 1:1, that God spoke and it was so. Again, I try to say something and it doesn't happen. But yet God, with the power of his word, he created all the physical things that we've seen, smell, touch, and all the things we can rationalize in our brain. God made it with the mere power of his word. And yet the apostle is saying here that you may know also what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe. Again, God is not asking to be understood. God is asking for us to believe that he can do all things according to his power. Now I'm going to say something here and it's going to maybe raise your antennas real quick, but don't discard me. It says, according. Verse 19, it says, according. In other words, this greatness power that God had has a limitation. Again, now let's study the text here real quick. It says here, according to the working of his mighty power. Now, it says according to the working. That word working is the word energia, or where we get the word energy. And then the word power right there is not the same power that you and I think. It's the word kratos in Greek, that it means dominion. So what the text is saying here, God has all power to do all that he can do according to the dominion where he possesses, and he can move and do what he needs to do. Now, let me go back again. Who created the heavens and the earth? God did. And inside the heavens and the earth, and even everything that was created, heaven and earth and under the earth, the things to come, everything, God has dominion to work in it because he has full authority to work in it. And yet, guess what? Guess where you live? Where God has dominion. And yet, the apostle is saying, if you are in Christ, if you are united in Christ, my prayer to you is that you may come to experience the mighty working power of God that can be in your life. And yet the greatest power that you and I possess today is that if you are saved by the grace of God, your sins have been removed as far as the east is from the west, and there is no way that God will remember, because he even says, I'll cast it in the sea of forgetfulness to remember it no more. And yet you want an example of this? Well, from verses 20 to 23, the Apostle Paul is going to show you how great is the power of God. Well, let's read verse 20. Which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. How powerful is God? He did a resurrection in Jesus Christ. Now you may say, Kevin, according to John chapter 11, he resurrected Lazarus. What's the difference between this resurrection and Christ's resurrection? Well, let me tell you something. Lazarus died again. But Jesus Christ came out of the tomb, to never, ever die again. And he lives forevermore sitting at the right hand of the Father. And guess who had that power? God demonstrated that power in Jesus Christ, so that you and I that believe, we may know we have a better and even assured, resurrection in Jesus Christ. Romans 4:25 says, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. Again, the power that God produced in Christ, it was for our benefit. 2 Corinthians 13:4 says, for though he was crucified through weakness, yet he liveth by the power of God. For we also are weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God toward you. Again, how powerful is God? He demonstrated in Christ that he raised him from the dead to never see corruption again. Amen? Think about that. Ponder on that. Keep on reading. Verse 20, it says, and sit him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. What God did in Jesus Christ, he raised him from the dead. But not only he raised him from the dead, he set him at the right hand of the majesty on high. And like what the Bible says, let this mind be in you. And in Philippians 2, that every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. For what purpose? For the glory of God the Father. And yet the Bible says we are seated with him in heavenly places. Amen? Amen. That's the power of God that he has in us. And let me tell you something. When God makes a decision, look what Job says here in Job 23:13. It says, but he is of one mind, and who can turn him? And what is his soul desire? Even that he does. In other words, what God does, who can say no against him? Who are we to tell him, I think you're doing a wrong thing here, God? No, when God raised Jesus Christ from the dead and he set him at his right hand, it was according to his divine purpose and his plan that we find in the previous verses. And yet, for what purpose? For our benefit. For our benefit. And look how high in authority Jesus is. Verse 21, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. You know how high Jesus is seated because God wanted to? Above everything you think that's authority. You think the White House has a high authority or the United Nations or whatever organization you want to call, Jesus is above that. You think you're the man of the house? May I tell you tonight, Jesus is above that. And even he says it, and he covers here at the very end, it says, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. So in this life, Jesus Christ is enough. Amen? The reason why you and I are going to heaven and we're going to spend all eternity in heaven is because of Jesus Christ. Because he is enough. He has all authority. You think in heaven we're just going to be doing nothing? No, we're going to praise the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. We're going to be in Revelation chapter 5 singing that new song, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us to receive power, dominion, honor, and glory forever and ever. I'm going to be there because of Jesus Christ. And then verse 22 and 23, it says, and put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head of all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. In other words, man, if Jesus Christ fits in this world, everything at the end is going to come to the culmination of Jesus Christ. And again, let's read verse number 10. Again, this is the purpose of the whole book, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are in earth, even in him. Therefore, Christ is through it all, for it all, and for the glory of God the Father. And yet, if we go back to verse 19, pay attention now. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe according to the working of his mighty power? You saw the example in Jesus Christ. My question is, can God do it in you also? Can God do it in me? Oh, I pray that God may show his exceeding great power towards me, that I may boldly profess the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the name that's above all name, for the glory of God the Father. That Parkwood Baptist Church, brethren, that we may come to the knowledge of God, that we may understand we're not operating in our own power, we're operating in the divine power of God. That's why when we come here Sunday and Wednesday, whatever service that we come, that souls may hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it's not Wesley's Bearfield word or Kevin Vargas word or whoever comes behind this pulpit, but is the word of the power, mighty, working God. that is the one that is enough to save souls, that makes a difference. I hear a lot of people, and I go to the jail services, and they always tell me, oh, I heard this, I've heard people do this miracle and this miracle, and I say, praise God. But I tell them, you know what, the greater miracle of all of it, that God can scoop down and save a sinner just like me and save him for all eternity, was his great exceeding power. Because only he can do the difference. He's the only one that will make a difference in this church. He's the only one that will make a difference in this world and even in the world to come. Because he's the only one that is worthy. And yet this great and mighty God, the Apostle Paul is praying that God may show you his power. You know, sometimes people take it lightly when they say, well, to serve God, you have to be behind a pulpit. False. False. You going to your job, being a good Christian, being a good worker, and professing the name of Jesus, that's a good work in and of itself. And it's not you. It's the Lord in you and working through you. When people see you, who do they see? Do they see me or do they see Jesus Christ, a different person? My prayer is that hopefully that one day, the day that I die, they may say, this is a man that really knew God because God was working through and through him. And just to finish, let me tell you this little story that I found very, very interesting. It's in the book of Prince Caspian on the Chronicles of Narnia. Pretty good book. C.S. Lewis wrote that book for the children to understand the Bible. And I love Aslan. I just love everything there is to it. I like the Chronicles of Narnia. But look at this little quote. When I read it, when I was studying for this, and I found this quote, and I said, this is exactly how I want to conclude this service. Let's listen to this. It's a conversation. It says, Aslan said, Lucy, you're bigger. Aslan answers, that is because you're older, little one. Answer he, not because you are. I'm not. But every year you grow, you'll find me bigger. Ponder on that for a second. Every time or every year, let's say you turn another age, and if you spend time with God, it's not that all of a sudden God becomes bigger. No, you come to understand how much he has revealed to you. My prayer tonight at Parkwood Baptist Church that we pray for one another in this matter, that we may know the excellency of God, that God may enlighten our eyes, and that we may know the exceeding greatness of his power toward us that believe. So I want to do something different for concluding tonight. Just take 2 minutes, be in silence, and pray for someone that you may be in your heart. You may know, you may be struggling with, or maybe they're going through something, just pray for them the same matter that the Apostle Paul prayed here, that they may know God. So just 2 minutes, if you don't mind, just be in your chairs, and then I'll finish up in a word of prayer.